Hello, I'm Dave Mowitz, and welcome to Successful Farming. This program marks the start of the 12th season of the show, and the Successful Farming family wants to thank you for inviting us into your home each week. And we invite you to be part of our family by sending in your suggestions on how we can improve the show. Please contact us at agriculture.com/TV. Now, onto the show. Today, our engine expert Ray Bohax explains why antifreeze comes in different colors. I track the prices being given on John Deere chore tractors, and in particular, a model 4320. We feature an innovative Bale spear attachment on all around the farm. And after these brief messages, I tour an innovative shop on the We Feed You farm in Central Ohio. So please stay tuned. Welcome to Top Shops. The crew and I are in Radnor, Ohio, visiting with Matt King, who farms with his stepfather, Jim Rodman. This farm team devised a first-rate shop that incorporates a number of unique design components. Let's go talk to Matt about We Feed You Farm Shop. Matt, thank you for letting this come out. You guys are in the middle of just getting done cutting wheat. You've got other crops going on, and you're a crop adjuster too as well. You guys are always moving, so I appreciate you taking time and letting us come out to see this great shop. You studied kind of what you wanted in shops for a few years before you put this up. What did you settle on the size of structure?
We ended up, after looking at a number of facilities, we decided on 80 by 136 for our final design.
Yeah, and then the sidewalls are 18?
Yes, we went with an 18-foot sidewall ceiling.
And that was clearance to get equipment in and out?
Essentially, it was clearance to get equipment in and out, but one of the things we liked about the 18-foot is actually if we wanted to unfold the combine bins inside, so if you wanted to work on something inside, you could do that.
Jim, your stepfather and you went out and looked at other shops prior to putting this thing up to kind of figure out what you needed?
Yeah, we did. We toured some local farmers in the area that already built shops, and we also went out a little distance. We did that because we weren't set on a final design when we put it together, so we wanted to see what other people had done and see what other people liked and didn't like before we finally settled on a product.
Was that worth the time?
Oh, it was absolutely worth the time, because we would stop into people's facilities and immediately say, oh, I love this, or immediately say, this isn't quite for us. And right. It was one of the best ways for our creative juices to get flowing and know how to come up with a bigger plan.
Now, typically, I wait and ask this question at the end, but I'll just hit you with it right up front. After all that study, and now you've got this structure, what would you do different?
I think the biggest thing, obviously bigger, right? Everybody says bigger. We probably could go bigger, but
the number one answer,
right? You can never build things big enough.
Right.
But actually, the number one thing we would like to do different is across the top of the building, we have the paneling, the metal sheeting, right. And we would have preferred to put some perforated in, either all of it or a little bit of it, to dampen the echo. It can get quite echoey in here when it's pretty empty.
Hey, this is a first. Jim and Matt employed a product called Fiber Tech to cover the bottom of their shop. This wall board is otherwise used in refrigerated trucks and is noted for its durability and ease of cleaning.
Yeah, so what we decided was we went into a lot of shops that had, the plywood up or some of them had the sheeting all the way down,
right.
and so forth. But what we had actually decided on is we used a fiberglass paneling product. They line inside of semi-trucks with it, or you'll commonly see it on a hog barn,
right.
On the back wall of a hog barn. And what it allowed us to do is it's completely waterproof, so we could, if you get water up on it, spray it. But another feature we loved about it is we use it as a whiteboard. I mean, you can write on it, you can, just with dry erase markers, and then you can buy and wipe it back off. So we use it as a multifunction surface, and it also stays cleaner than just your typical painted plywood, so it's an easier to clean product.
You mentioned about the sidewall and you write things on it. It's more than the oil changes. You even have quote board over here on the side of the shop.
Yeah, it kind of started, one of these days, one of us grabbed a dry erase marker and we wrote some quotes on the wall, and then it's kind of grown from there. And so, yeah, it serves a lot of purposes. And now we've got this, we'll call it the motivational wall, where, we've got a lot of quotes of neighbors, friends, and people. So
another aspect I noticed was your floor treatment. This is just not plain concrete. Well, it is just plain concrete, but it has a color to it.
Yeah, so one of the things when we toured other people's shop, we asked about painting the floor versus a straight concrete floor.
Epoxy.
Right.
As opposed to, right.
Exactly. And one of the things we heard was a lot of guys, you know, you drop a big hammer, it chips the floor, and then the color's out of it and all this. So we went a different direction. We actually put the dye right in the concrete. Oh. So when we poured it, the whole concrete slab itself is all this maroon or red color. And so whether if you chip it or anything like that, right. You still have the color throughout.
And then Jim was saying too, this doesn't have rebar in it, the concrete.
No, we did not put any rebar in it. What we did was we put the fiber in it.
Right.
Should last longer, less likely to crack and expand, especially with the heat changes and the humidity. It should not crack as easily with the fiber in it.
Here's another first for me. In quite literally the hundreds of shops that I've toured, Jim and Matt opted for on-demand boilers to feed their floor heat. These eliminated a central boiler and made zone heating their shop much easier. In addition, they used Creative Heat insulated foam panels in the insulation of their floor heat, which makes their heating system much more efficient.
With the on-demand heaters, they only run when they need to,
right.
and different parts. And the other reason we put it into zones, we actually put the facility into three zones, three different heating systems. The front of the place, we always keep in the winter a warmer temperature because we have offices and living room space, and plus the tool rooms up in the front. So we'll keep that up, at a 10 degree higher temp. Then in the back facility, we can actually control them independently or we can control them separately. And so what we could actually do is only heat part of the shop to a certain temperature. It just gives us some flexibility.
And they sit, those on-demand boilers, because they're much smaller, they sit right in the zone that they're heating in. They're right on the wall back here. And then they just take care of that area. Everything's out in the open. You didn't have to put them in a closet or anything like that.
No, everything's right out in the open. The heaters themselves sit on the walls, so if you need to do any maintenance or anything, it's right there. You can just walk up. You can punch them or set the settings or change the thermostat, they're all right there.
Jim and Matt opted to place the door on their end wall offset. This created a handy staging area for their machinery prior to, say, like the planting or harvest season.
So a lot of guys do center up their doors in the barn, but on ours, we didn't center the back door. One of the reasons why is we actually pushed it to one side versus centering it. So that then the side that is kind of we'll call it the wide side,
right.
During the winter months, we can back equipment in there. We back planters, sprayers, things like that you're worried about freezing. We can keep them in the heated shop. And then you still can get in and out that door because nothing's actually parked in front of the door. So it gives you a storage space by pushing that door to the side.
Matt, you have two full-time jobs. You farm with Jim, but then also you're a crop adjuster for ProAg.
Yeah,
you're getting around all over the countryside. So that's your other full-time job. That's why the office complex you have up front is so important to you. You spent a lot of time thinking about that, didn't you?
So I needed a space where I could office out of and have a facility. And I have people come in for training. I have people that actually stop by and work. So I built an office that was very large, had an extra space, an extra workspace for other people. As well as we built we'll call it a meeting common room area for just that purpose, hosting.
Right. And then coming off the shop, it goes into another, not another area, because you've kept this area as open as possible, but you have a tool room, which then opens up to the main shop.
Yeah, so what we did when we designed it is we tucked the tool room and the offices area up underneath the loft.
Right.
That way kept the shop floor as big as possible. Didn't eat up any shop floor space. But the tool room, it's kind of tucked under the loft. But we designed that so that, it's right next to one of our main doors. So you can pull in there with a pickup or you can pull in there with something. You can work right there's the workbench, right there's the tools right by the main door you pull in. So you don't have to walk 100 feet across the building to get something.
One of the best features I appreciate the most about the We Feed You Farm Shop is its position in the farmstead. Jim and Matt located their shop in the farmstead for easy access. And this is crucial if you're planning a shop for the future. Well, I'll see you again next week on another Top Shops Tour.
There's a lot of confusion today amongst farmers about antifreeze, and it's actually supposed to be called coolant. I'm Ray Bohax, a successful farming engine man, and I'm over in Columbiana, Ohio at the Firestone Test Farm, and we're gonna be discussing antifreeze. So this is basically gonna be, or coolant, I have to correct myself because I'm so used to saying it incorrectly, is that what I need to explain to you today, it's just like with crop production, it's not like it was years ago. When Grandpa and Dad farmed, antifreeze was green. Today there's all different colors. And there's a reason why they're different colors. This bottle I have here for an example is what is called orange antifreeze. So there's orange, there's traditional green, there's gold, or some people call it yellow, and there's also red. What you need to know as a farmer is two simple things. Number one, do not re-engineer the cooling system. If the manufacturer tells you to use an orange product or a green product or a red product, use it. Use what they tell you. It doesn't necessarily have to be their brand, but it has to be the chemical composition. And then the other thing is that what you have to understand is that antifreeze wears out. Engine coolant wears out. Its ability to freeze does not change unless it gets diluted with water, but the chemical additive package that actually make it a proper coolant is what becomes dissipated. And when it becomes dissipated, you end up having corrosion and electrolysis in the engine. So to recap, number one, use the proper coolant. If you have different, most farms have all different types of equipment, and you say, I want to buy one product, well, that's a compromise. You don't really want to compromise the cooling systems on your engines, because when they go bad, they cost a lot of money. Now, the other thing to keep in mind is that there are ethylene glycol-based antifreezes and propylene glycol-based antifreeze coolant. If you have an ethylene glycol-based antifreeze, you could check its freeze protection with a hydrometer like this. But the best way to check freeze protection on any antifreeze is to use a refractometer. And the refractometer needs to be calibrated for either propylene glycol or ethylene glycol. Now keep in mind that the freeze point has nothing to do with the concentration of the additive package, and that is why it's imperative that you service the cooling systems on all of your engines, and that's usually a time, miles, or hour criteria. And the other thing I want to touch on briefly here is that it is very important to have a solid mass of liquid in any engine for the cooling system, and you have to bleed the air out. The best way and the most efficient way to bleed, I love this tool, it's a radiator fill kit. It's by Lyle Company, and you could look it up, it's only about $20 or $25. You put this onto the radiator, you run the engine, you fill up the coolant through here, it allows all the air to bubble out, the system to be one solid mass of coolant, and everything will be perfect with no spillage on the ground. So listen, you have a blessed day, and make sure you change that antifreeze and use the proper product.
Join me at sale to see what John Deere 4320s sell for after these brief messages. Welcome to Steel Deals. I was walking the rows of equipment at today's consignment sale, and this John Deere 4320 caught my eye. What got me interested in this tractor is that this is one of those fresh off the farm machines that is being sought out both by farmers for chore tractor and for collectors who want it for restoration. The interest in muscle tractors from the 1960s, a trend that started with collectors over a decade ago, has now expanded into horsepower built in the 1970s. And this new generation tractor, which was a replacement for the hugely popular 4020, was built for just 2 years. That makes it highly sought after by collectors. Now, what adds value to this tractor is that it's in great original condition with just a little over 7,500 hours. Shoot, it even has brand new front tires. Now, this tractor sold for $12,000 when it was new in 1972. So will it bring money like that many years later? Let's go ask Tim Meyer, Steffes Auction, for his opinion on that question. Tim, we're looking at that Deere 4320. Now that was a tractor not that long ago. It was just strictly a chore tractor, but now collectors are beginning to snap them up. So what does that do for a tractor selling like this one at today's auction?
What's ironic, Dave, is that tractor when it came out was a big tractor.
Yeah.
And in today's world, that tractor is a very useful tractor from a utility standpoint. But yeah, that's a tractor a farmer could buy, take home, use it on their own farm, maybe parade it, maybe someday clean it up, fix it up a little bit, but it's got a lot of potential.
That tractor is really in great shape. It is a second owner, but it's fresh off the farm, and God, it's in great original shape, right?
You know what? That is an honest tractor. It absolutely comes off the farm. I really like the look of that tractor. It's very, very original. Yeah, definitely. It comes right off the farm, local tractor here.
Not only that, it has new front tires.
New front tires, yes.
And a special kind of a step.
It's got a 50 series step on it, which, you know what? I'm gonna need one of those one of these days.
Yeah, you and I both. Besides, if you were to get it for like a road tractor, you know, to go on tractor parades or these tractor trips that they're taking, that'd be perfect for you to get up and down the tractor, that's for sure. So it's gonna be tough to kind of put a price on that. It's sold for $12,000 original. We've actually seen some 4020s 1206s bring beyond the original price. You think it'll break that today?
I think we're maybe going to get close, but I've got that tractor pegged around 8 to 10. I think if it had rear tires, maybe a little bit fresher paint job, we could get into that new retail price of around 12, maybe even a little bit more.
But that's a very solid price for a tractor of that interest, I take it. It was only built for 2 years, so collectors are beginning to clamor for that, aren't they?
Absolutely, and you can only buy them when they're for sale, Dave.
Well, thanks for that information, Tim. Let's watch the 4320 sell.
Empire, give me 6,000, let's go. Empire, better than 6,000, now 7, 7, 7, 6, 7, time dollar. It's 6,500, now 7, time to buy. It's 65, better than 7, now 75. It's 7, better than 75, better than 8,000, better than 8,500. 85, better than 9,000, dollar, but 9,000, better than 9,500. And 95, better than 10,000, dollar, 4, 10, 10, 10, better than 10, better than 95, 10. And 95, better than 10,000, dollar, 10, 10, better than 10, better than 95, 10. And 95, better than 10, give me 97.5. 95, bid 7.5. 95, better than 7, better than 7, better than 95, 7.5, down 10. 10,
So today's tractor certainly brought the money I expected. Remember, 4320s were listed new for $12,000. Imagine a 46-year-old tractor bringing close to like-new prices. But I'm not surprised. You see, prior to coming to today's sale, I spent time searching for past sales of these tractors. At auction, they were bringing between $4,400 up to $17,000. That $4,400 tractor had some serious engine problems where the $17,000 tractor was restored. Now, I also found a number of dealer listings, about 12 of them for 4320s. And these were being sold for between about $9,500 up to $45,000. Now, the average dealer asking price for these tractors was $12,750. So today's tractor certainly brought the money I expected based on solid price research. You can catch my used equipment reports in every issue of Successful Farming magazine. And for more information about the Steffes Group and their upcoming sales, you can go to the website at steffesauctioneers.com. I'll see you again next week on another Steel Deals report. After these brief messages, we feature an innovative Bale spear attachment. So please stay tuned.
Hi, I'm Derek Antofer of Dedham, Iowa. Today I'm showing you my bale spear I made last winter. During hay season, I'm always taking the three-point bale spear on and off every day. I don't get done picking up in one day. It just gets old and tiring, so I wanted a quicker way to put the bales on, or bale spears on, so I made this three-point attachment. I already had the spears, so I just had to make inserts for the spears to go through. And so when I get done mixing cattle, feeding cattle for the day, I can unhook the feed wagon, pull ahead a few feet, slide the bale spears in and I'm ready to pick up hay. It took me about 2 to 3 days to build and a couple hundred bucks in steel and bale tines that I already had and a little paint and I was done. When I'm not using the bale spears, I set them by the feed wagon where I unhook, and when I do need them, they're right there and I slap them in and ready to pick up hay for the day. For more about this idea and other farmer inventions, go to agriculture.com/TV.
Please join us next week for another outstanding show. We feature how a family in Ohio utilized the gift of precision ag equipment on their operation. Rob Sharkey, the shark farmer, is back with his unique perspective on agriculture. I tracked the sale of a Cat E5 to get an idea of what used haulers are selling for. And visit with Don Landall of Landall Corporation about the tractor he grew up using on his family farm in Kansas. See you next week right here on Successful Farming. Hi, I'm Dave Mowitz. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, hit subscribe right here if you haven't already, and click that little bell right here to be notified when we post a new video. And click here to see more great episodes from Successful Farming Television.